Good morning. Welcome. It's good to have everybody here this morning. This is a Reformation Sunday. It's a time every year that we celebrate what happened in the 16th century of when God restored to us the biblical understanding of Christianity. It's by grace alone, by faith alone, by God alone. God be the glory. Everything is dependent on Him. And so we celebrate that, and we'll make reference to that here and there throughout the service. Again, it's just great to have you here this morning. Invite you now just to still yourself a little bit and prepare your hearts to worship.
Thank you.
I invite you now to stand as we enter and begin our time of worship and hear God's call to worship, taken from Psalm 46. And the reminder, this is God just inviting us to come close to Him, to see how beautiful He is, and see Him as He really is, to reform our hearts and our minds from the distorted views we have of Him, and see how good He is. Let's read this together responsively. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Please join me in prayer. Lord, as we just sang about, you are our fortress. That is, you are our true home. In you alone are we safe and sound. You protect us, Lord, and you pursue us. You are our helper, our truest friend. And without you, we recognize once again that we're alone and truly helpless. Thank you for rescuing us, for finding a way to save us that isn't based on our performance. You care so well for us, Lord, giving us friends and family that reflect your deep love for us. Thank you. Lord, you know that we are fearful and scared people. We ask you this morning to open our eyes, give us confidence, fill our hearts to who you are, what you have done for us, what you are doing for us even at this very moment, and what you promise to do for us in the future. Give us faith, give us love, Lord. We love you. And to that end, we pray the prayer that your Son taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we have a confession of faith before us. This is taken from the Heidelberg Catechism. Catechism is just a teaching tool. It's a question-answer tool. This isn't the Word of God, but the catechisms take truths from God's Scripture, put it in this form of question and answer so we can get our heads and our hearts around the truths of God's word so it reshapes us and reforms us. And so let's read this responsively. What is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with this precious blood, and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life, and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. What must you know to live and die in the joy of this comfort? Three things. First, how great my sin and misery are. Second, how I am set free from all my sins and misery. Third, how I am to thank God for such deliverance.
Thank you.
Please be seated. So we come to confession. Confession is really something very countercultural. You know, we live in a society today that really encourages us to hide our flaws, to put ourselves in the best light possible, and to appear better than we are. And our culture does insist that all humans are pretty good and deny the reality of sin and the brokenness that we have. Confession is a place where we can authentically bring our sin, our weakness, our human brokenness to God. And in bringing so, find true freedom, true grace. It's an opportunity for us to hear once again to Him from God Himself saying, I love you and I do not condemn you. So I invite you now to use the kneelers if you're so inclined as we begin our time of confession. I'm going to read from Isaiah, and then we'll have a time of corporate confession and then a time of silent confession. Let's turn to the Lord now and be honest. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. Together we pray. Behold, Lord, I am an empty vessel that needs to be filled. My Lord, fill it. I am weak in the faith. Strengthen me. I am cold in love. Warm me and make me fervent, that my love may go out to my neighbor. I do not have a strong and firm faith. At times I doubt and am unable to trust you altogether. O Lord, help me. Strengthen my faith and trust in you. In you I have sealed the treasure of all I have. I am poor, you are rich, and came to be merciful to the poor. I am a sinner, you are upright. With me there is an abundance of sin. In you is the fullness of righteousness. Therefore I will remain with you, of whom I can receive, but to whom I may not give. Lord, hear us now as we bring to you our silent and individual prayers of confession. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to stand now and let these words wash over you, this assurance of pardon. God wants us to know that we're His. We're forgiven not because of anything we do, that is like our good works, but we're forgiven because of who He is, by His grace. If you have Jesus, you have forgiveness forever. You can never lose that. Let's hear this truth proclaimed through these scriptures. I'll read what's in our bulletin, and then we will respond by singing the doxology. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. We respond to God's forgiveness by living our thanks according to His word. Hear now God's will for our lives. Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets.
Thank you. Please be seated. Let's pray. Let's pray now. Some prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. Of course, God's big. He can hear your prayers at the same time. I will lead us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We are met this morning with beauty outside that reminds me of a God that is so creative, a God that delights to do good and wonderful things that spark our imagination. Father, thank you for your creation. I pray, Lord, that you would help it to spark love in our hearts for you. Father, we are thankful for so many things in our lives, for our friends and for our family. We give you thanks for our jobs, for our homes, for our shelter. We give you thanks. Lord, forgive us forgive me for always looking for what I don't have and not rejoicing for what you've given and seeing all the wonderful things you've given us. Make us grateful people. Make us a grateful community, a grateful church, Lord. Teach us how to be thankful. Father, we lift up to you this morning, those in our congregation, on our hearts, in our circles that we love and that we know you love, and our hearts break for them because of different things. We pray for Rachel Russell this morning, who recently lost her mother. Dear Lord, we beg you to comfort her, be close to her, such a great loss. Father, for those who are battling with physical ailments, we lift up Cheryl and Diane, for Julie, for Sue and Tex, for Charles, for Jane, for others on our heart, Lord. Please be gracious to them. We ask that you'd heal them. If it's not your will, Lord, you comfort them. Somehow show them even this day that you are close. Lord, we pray also for those that we know that are lonely, and they're just hurting, either relationally hurting or financially or emotionally for whatever reason. We just lift them to you, and we ask that you would open our eyes to those around us, that you've, in our workplaces, in our families even, that we can be your hands and be gracious and reflect your heart to them. Show us, Lord. Lord, we ask for peace from the Middle East, for the conflict. We ask that also that you would make us peacemakers in the conflicts that surround our lives and that we step into. Lord, help us to proclaim your gospel in whatever way we can. Lord, now we ask as we close that you would just prepare for us to hear from your word, that you would change us. Help us not just to listen out of academic reasons, but that we want to be teachable. Give us ears to hear. Change us. Lord, help us to see you clearly so we can love others correctly. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, welcome again. It's good to have you here this day. Few announcements. As always, if you're new here, we have all these announcements in the back of the bulletin and give you more details. Just want to remind you of a few. And before I do that, I just want to encourage you to pass those little pads somewhere in your pew, just a way to get to know each other. Pass it down one time and then pass it back if you don't mind. Just check out the names and learn and greet one another. Want to let you know that we have a big event this afternoon that we began last year. It's a barn dance at a farm about 30 miles away from here, 30 minutes away from here, rather. And it's a beautiful setting. Want to encourage you to come. There's some information in the bulletin. Some of it may be a little wrong. There's not going to be chili dogs, but there's going to be chili and hot dogs. You can combine them if you like. You don't have to. So don't let that spoil you coming. You bring your own food if you don't like either of those. Actually, if you could bring a side dish, if you have time, we're going to share those side dishes. If you don't bring anything, there's no shame. Just come. We want you to be there. That's the big thing, is just to be together and to enjoy each other. There'll be some square dancing by what I hear is a good caller. I don't know what a good caller is, but I hear he or she is really good. You don't have to dance. Again, we just want you there. It's huge fields. Bring a frisbee or football. There's a creek that goes by. Knock yourself out. It's just a fun time to be together. 4 to 6:30. We'd love to see you there. Yes, and also I saw that the Christmas shoe boxes are just by the big staircase over there when you go out. This is a Operation Christmas Child every year that provides gifts for children around the world who probably don't get any gifts. And so if it's a fun thing, a meaningful thing for maybe you and your kids to, or you just to go and get some of the, they have a shopping list for you. And you put it all together and bring it back. They had to bring it back by early November, the date's out there, just so they have time to ship it and arrive on by Christmas. So I encourage you to do that. It's a great way to love up on some people. And now let's continue our worship by bringing to God his gifts and our gifts and the tithes, and just remembering that God's reforming us. He's reshaping our understanding of what true life is. True life really is to be a giver. And to give, and to be a servant, and so we are doing what God does. He gives us so much, and so we have a chance to give back and to be a part of His ministry, His kingdom work. So let's do that now as the choir sings this offertory music.
Well, I feel that's hard to follow. My voice, there's nothing special about my voice at any level. So good morning again. To echo what Phil said, we're so glad that you're here to be with us to worship. If you're new here, just a special welcome to you. We hope you feel warmly welcomed in our fellowship this morning. We are continuing with a series that we've been going through in the book of Daniel. So it's our practice to read through the Bible and take the text that comes next. And we choose different books, try to get a good diet of Old Testament and New Testament. And we've been in the book of Daniel this fall. And this morning, we're in the first half of chapter 9, verses 1 through 19. And so if you have a Bible and you want to look there, you can open up there with me. Just as a reminder, the context of Daniel, the context of the story that we're reading is Israel's life in Babylon. So they've been deported from the land, and they are now in a foreign place under foreign rule. And the question that we've been asking as we've read along and we've studied this book is, what does faithfulness look like in that place? What does faithfulness for Israel look like in the land of Babylon? The words of the psalmist in Psalm 137 put it well. The psalmist, about this very context, says this: how do we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? So we're talking about exilic discipleship, or just to put it even more simply, following Jesus in a culture that doesn't know him. I've told you before that Daniel kind of divides into two main sections. The first section is the first half of the book, chapters 1 through 6. Those are just stories, very recognizable to us, narratives about Daniel and his friends who are in the life of public service there in the royal house in Babylon. The next six chapters, the chapters we're in, is the strange stuff for us. It's the apocalyptic. With all that being said, we are in the apocalyptic section, and yet this morning, maybe to your disappointment, is very ordinary. It's a Bible study and it's prayer. And it's Daniel. We used to call that a quiet time, by the way. It's basically what we get. But it's a glimpse of Daniel. And remember, at this point, Daniel's about 80 years old. And it's a glimpse of Daniel at 80, still learning and still praying and still seeking God faithfully, though he has been exiled now away from his homeland for 70 years. And this is toward the end of his days. So for our young disciples this morning, a couple of questions for you to think about. I'd love for you to answer at the end of this. Number one, where does Daniel get his prayer? So he rips it off from somewhere. Where does Daniel rip off his prayer? Where does he get it from? Where does Daniel learn to pray? And then where do we learn to pray? If you're able, I'd ask you to stand now for the reading of God's holy word, Daniel chapter 9, verses 1 through 19. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, by descent a Mede, who was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, perceived in the books the number of years that, according to the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet, must pass before the end of the desolations of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. Then I turned my face to the Lord God, seeking him by prayer and pleas for mercy, with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession, saying, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, we have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled, turning aside from your commandments and your rules. We have not listened to your servants the prophets who spoke in your name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. To you, O Lord, belongs righteousness, but to us open shame. As at this day, to the men of Judah, to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and to all Israel, those who are near and those who are far away, in all the lands to which you have driven them, because of the treachery that they have committed against you. To us, O Lord, belongs open shame, to our kings, to our princes, and to our fathers, because we have sinned against you. To the Lord our God belongs mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by walking in his laws, which he has set before us by his servants, the prophets. All Israel has transgressed your law and turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. And the curse and oath that are written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, have been poured out upon us because we have sinned against him. He has confirmed his words, which he spoke against us and against our rulers who ruled us, by bringing upon us a great calamity. For under the whole of heaven there has not been done anything like what has been done against Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come up upon us. Yet we have not entreated the favor of the Lord our God, turning from our iniquities and gaining insight by your truth. Therefore the Lord has kept ready the calamity and has brought it upon us. For the Lord our God is righteous in all the works that he has done, and we have not obeyed his voice. And now, O Lord our God, who brought your people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand, and have made a name for yourself, as at this day we have sinned, we have done wickedly. O Lord, according to all your righteous acts, let your anger and your wrath turn away from your city, Jerusalem, your holy hill, because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and your people have become a byword among all who are around us. Now therefore, O God, listen to the prayer of your servant, to his pleas for mercy, and for your own sake, O Lord, make your face to shine upon your sanctuary, which is desolate. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations, the city that is called by your name. For we do not present our pleas before you because of our own righteousness, but because of your great mercy. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, pay attention and act. Delay not for your name's sake, O my God, because your city and your people are called by your name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let me pray for us. Father, we pray that you would help us to understand what you've given us in your word, that you would, by your spirit, not just help us understand it, but, Father, to have it penetrate our hearts and to form our affections and to create a deeper love and trust in you, even as you form us more to the image of your Son, we are able to better love others. And so we pray that all this would happen, that you would move us in that direction this morning as we open your word together. Pray in Jesus' name, amen. So two things I want us to look at this morning. Just go ahead and tell you, sometimes you want to know this, but the first part's longer, the second part's pretty short. The first thing we're going to look at this morning is what is the major part of the passage, and that's just the content of Daniel's prayer. So what does he pray, and why does he pray it? And then second, we're going to look at the source of Daniel's prayer. Where does Daniel learn to pray like this? What sources him coming before God like this? So the content and the source, Daniel is praying in Babylon. What can we learn from him? So first, the content of Daniel's prayer. What does Daniel pray? The big picture here, and the first thing that you might notice when we read through that together, is that Daniel is praying primarily a prayer of repentance, or a prayer of contrition, or a prayer of lament, or a prayer of confession of sin. All those things would be true. Even in verse 3, you see that Daniel tells us that he's going to pray, and he's going to put on fast, or he's going to fast, and he's going to put on sackcloth and ashes. That was just an ancient way of wearing, like, all black for a funeral. When you wear sackcloth and ashes, you're humbling yourself by what you wear. You're connecting yourself with nothingness in some way, and it's posturing yourself for grief. And Daniel is doing that. He's taking on the posture of grief, but in this case, it's grief over sin. And that forms the bulk of the prayer from verses 4 through 15. Daniel is grieving sin in God's presence. He is lamenting the rebellion of Israel. And I just want you to notice in the prayer, if you're just reading it, he doesn't ask for anything until the very end, verses 16 through 19. So not just petitioning God, that's the very, very end. Now here's something that I think we all ought to be curious about this morning, if you read that prayer with me. Why in the world is Daniel offering to God a prayer of repentance right now? Because this prayer is time-stamped. We have a context for it. So why now, of all the prayers he could offer to God, do we get a prayer of repentance? Here's where that's curious. Go back to me with verse 1. Again, the context. This is the first year of the reign of Darius the Mede. And you may remember that that's when the Persians took over. So this is year 1 of Israel now living apart from their oppressors. Babylon has been destroyed, and they're now under Persian rule. And in verse 2, we learn that Daniel has been reading the prophet who? The prophet Jeremiah. You may have heard of him. He wasn't much older than Daniel. And Daniel has perceived in his reading of Jeremiah that in some form, Israel's exile is coming to an end. Jeremiah 25 and Jeremiah 29 is probably where he is. They both mention a period of 70 years, which Daniel mentions here. So whether that 70 is a round number, whether it's an exact number, whether it's a representative number, it doesn't really matter that much here. What it means for us is that this is the news that is driving this prayer from Daniel. And that news, in summary, is this: the judgment of Daniel's enemies, his oppressors, has come. The discipline or the judgment of Israel is ending because the exile has been time-stamped by God. And now here we are with Daniel at the very finish line. So here's what I want you to be curious about. In light of all of this, why in the world do we have a prayer of repentance instead of a prayer of what? Thanksgiving. Why sackcloth and ashes? Why not break out the champagne? Why is it that good news, such good news of God's deliverance, final deliverance for them, has moved Daniel to overwhelming sorrow? It's weird. It should be weird for us, and it's worth for us considering that relationship this morning. So if you go back to the prayer and you went through that prayer, especially verses 4 through 16, and you examined the way that Daniel arranges the prayer, here's basically what you would find on almost every line. There is in that prayer a repeated contrast between who God is. The character of God, the love of God, the righteousness of God, the mercy of God, and who Israel is. It's pretty bleak. Their shame, their wickedness, their rebellion, their refusal to listen and obey. Over and over again, you get the same thing. And what Daniel is doing in this prayer is he's lining up those two parties, those two covenant partners side by side, and he's saying that when I line these two up, there is a tremendous gulf there. There is this tremendous chasm between God, who is the blesser, and Israel, the recipients of the blessing. And so what Daniel sees here is that the people who are getting God's deliverance and his blessing, those people are actually unfit for the love and faithfulness that Yahweh is about to shower upon them. Last weekend, my family and I were out of town. We were invited generously to sit and watch a football game in the suite of a Hall of Fame quarterback, NFL quarterback. So he had invited us, he hosted us, we watched a game with he and his family. He invited us into the life of his family. And there was another famous former NFL player there. And what these two men had in common, among other things, was both were Super Bowl MVPs at some point. So in the pantheon of NFL greats. And I took a picture with them, and so did my three boys. And so just to kind of let you know, there are three adults in that picture with my three boys. And I could tell you the names of these players, and many of you would know those names. But if you were sitting here this morning and you knew nothing about football, and I didn't tell you any of their names, or you, which I won't do, and you wouldn't know, or if you wouldn't even know a name of a football player, if I asked you to look at that picture and answer the question, who in the picture out of the three adults do you think has never won a Super Bowl MVP? No matter who you are, the answer would be amazingly clear. You would know exactly who the guest was. You'd be able to immediately tell who didn't belong in the picture. And I can tell you that as a guest in that place where I entered exclusively through the generosity of their merits, I can tell you how I feel. I felt grateful, but also there was this deep feeling of deference. You know, I never looked around at the furniture in the suite and said, you could have done better with that couch. Or looked at the food sitting out and said, where's the smoothie bar? You know, it's a feeling that that grace almost destroys entitlement. The absence of being in greatness and being invited in that destroys entitlement. And what you feel is deference or even reverence in their presence. So can you imagine if you had a picture of Israel standing next to the radiance of Yahweh? And you had that picture side by side, and you saw on one end a holy God who was hosting a people who had sinned against him on a deeply personal level. That's what the covenant is. Because that's the picture that Daniel is looking at here. And he sees himself in that picture. And when he looks at that picture, it's not just gratitude he feels, it is also lament and sorrow. And don't get the wrong impression here. Just because you have lament doesn't mean you don't have joy. You can hold joy and sorrow together. But lament that God would put himself in fellowship as the host of a people who have made so little of his generosity. And so with that in mind, you maybe see how in light of the good news of God's deliverance, in light of the news of his faithfulness and the renewing of that faithfulness, do you see how as the recipient, that news would actually humble you and make you say something like, "Oh Lord, in your worthiness, I see my own unworthiness. It's exposed. And I am deeply, deeply sorry." You know, something of this feeling is probably what made John Newton say this. He said, if you walk closely with God for 40 years, so this is it's twice that for Daniel. If you walk closely with God for 40 years, you will at the end of that time have a much lower opinion of yourself than you do now. Did you know that's what you signed up for? And that's not because you're not valuable or your existence or your gifts don't matter. It's not because what you have to offer is nothing. It's just because in this covenant friendship, the relationship is pretty one-sided. And it's in light of God's grace that your sin doesn't just become visible to you. It's in light of his goodness and grace that you grieve it and that it becomes sad and yucky to you. You know, Phil mentioned this, but maybe the bagpipes tipped it off as well. This is Reformation Sunday. We don't usually have bagpipes here if you're visiting here. It's the day that we celebrate. It's hard to date the Reformation, but the day we celebrate an important point, which is Martin Luther's act of nailing his 95 theses to the door of the church in Wittenberg, Germany. In the act of doing that, what Luther really wanted, or what he hoped for, was that the church, us, that we would be reclaimed by the grace of God in all of its transformational power. That the good news of the gospel would be first and foremost in how we thought about life and how we thought about who God is and who we thought about who we are. And for all the ways that Luther could have begun that with those 95 theses in hopes that the church would know and believe and internalize the grace of God, this was his first thesis. When our Lord and Master Jesus Christ said, "Repent," he willed that the entire life of, get this, believers, that the entire life of believers would be one of repentance. So when Luther wanted to think about recapturing the grace of the gospel, he brought up repentance. For who? For believers. Not the wicked Babylonians. That's exactly what's going on here. Daniel is finding his prayer glued to the promises of God in Jeremiah, those promises of deliverance from exile in spite of the people. Glued to those promises. And when that happens, you don't say, "Well, God, it's about time you came through for us. Here I've been faithful standing among the wickedness of this other nation, and it's about time you acted and did something." No. When your prayer life gets glued to the promises of God, you give thanks and pray for the grace to live in those promises, and you lament the ways that you haven't lived in them. Because for a Christian, do you know this, that you get to wake up every morning with the grace of a new start. You get to wake up every morning with the grace of a new start, and that is amazing, and repentance is the way that you take hold of that. The entire life of believers, God has willed to be one of repentance. Yet there's a deeper grace hinted at here, and it's Daniel as a shadow of why we can even trust that repentance is a grace for us in the first place. This is really important. I want you to notice what Daniel's doing here. He is confessing the sins of Israel, but if you've read back over this and you've kind of have a sense of where we've been so far, you'll notice that what he's confessing specifically are the sins that led to the exile, most of which occurred before Daniel was even born. So relatively speaking, as he's making this confession, Daniel's hands are pretty clean. You know, I want you to notice how he prays. Notice the pronouns in the prayer. He says, "We have sinned." He says, "Our hands are dirty." He says, "It's our shame, it's our wickedness." And so Daniel is confessing these sins as his own. Why? Because that's what a covenant is. He sees himself completely bound up with the people in covenant, with their past as well as their future. And so he can summarize all the sins that have taken place over generations, and he can count himself as part of it all. You see what he's doing? He's getting up and he's repenting on behalf of the people. And who do you think will benefit from Daniel repenting on behalf of the people? Not just Daniel, but the people. And so here's what we have here. We have Daniel as an intercessor, studying the Bible with relatively no blood on his hands, at least in this context, who was carried away and who suffered the covenant curses of exile for himself, and who tried to live faithfully for the benefit of everyone else in that exile. And we look at Daniel, and we often do, and say, you know what, that's heroic. And so along those lines, what would you think about Jesus? The one that the Bible says was not forced into exile, but who chose exile for us, who left his throne above to live in our brokenness. The one, unlike Daniel, who wasn't just relatively clean, but who had absolutely no stain upon him whatsoever. The one, though whom he had nothing to repent for, underwent a baptism of repentance. Do you remember John's gospel? You ever wonder about this? John's gospel is it's a baptism of repentance. So why in the world does Jesus do that? Guess what? To identify with you. To put himself among the covenant people. The one who not only prayed in the gap, but who found the source of that gap, and who died there on the cross. With all the fullness of the covenant curses and the fullness of exile falling upon him. And he does all that so that through the reverence of his life, through his intercession, through his faithfulness, he does it so God will clothe you. So that you benefit. God clothes you in the righteousness of Jesus. And when you are clothed in the righteousness of Jesus, you belong in that suite. You belong in the picture. And that is something your own repentance can never achieve for you. If you haven't been listening, will you listen to me now? No matter how much you lament, no matter how much you cry, no matter how sincere you are, no matter the sincerity of your own thought about your own sin, you can never do enough crying and mourning and lamenting to secure God's blessing for you. It is Jesus alone standing for you. And we repent now, not to get him. We repent now because we already have him. As J.I. Packer has said, repentance is simply giving as much as you know of yourself to as much as you know of who Jesus is, and we're hoping that both those things will increase. But I want you to see the order in the prayer. It's really important. It's the same order of the Exodus. There is deliverance, a promise of deliverance, and then there's repentance. There is always good news, and then there's an invitation to repent in light of it. God is not only our promise keeper in Christ, he is also our promise maker and our promise fulfillment. So while also in the restoration part of the prayer there, if you'll just look there just for a moment, you'll just notice, you can go back over it. Daniel never appeals to his own righteousness for God to act. He appeals to God's name or his reputation, as short for his character. So God, act for us on the basis of yourself. That's exactly what he does in Jesus Christ. That's the content of David's prayer. It's a model of devotion and humbly walking with God for us. And now just a brief word, I promise, about the source of that prayer. It's the only thing I want to point out here. Daniel prays this prayer because why? He prays this prayer because he is reading his Bible. This doesn't happen much in the Old Testament where you have an actual author reading another author in the same canon. But he is reading the scroll of Jeremiah. If you read his prayer, however, you'll notice it's not just Jeremiah. It is Deuteronomy. It is the Exodus. It is all the historical books. And what's happening in Daniel's life is the word of God is literally coming to life in his devotion. In fact, if you'll remember Jeremiah's letter, maybe you remember it. We talked about it the first week, Jeremiah 29, likely what he was reading here. In that letter, God commands the exiles to seek me with all your heart. It's the same word used here in Daniel verse 3, chapter 9. I turn my face to the Lord seeking him. So what I want you to see is that Daniel has learned to pray. He has learned a language for prayer. He has learned the grace to be bold in prayer from the words that God has given him. So here's the challenge for you as you go home, as you leave here today. Don't just treat this as a theological library or a place to go get answers to questions about life or a way to make sense of things. You should treat it like that. This is what God has given you as a prayer book. This is where you learn to pray. And there will be a lot of times in your life where you open this and you have zero idea what it means. Guess what you can still do? You can still pray. You can pray the words, you don't even know what they say. You can tell God that. Learn to pray through reading the Word of God. And I know this occurs to me that we often think that when we do this, it impersonalizes things. I'm telling you, the biggest restriction in your prayer life is your own imagination. You restrict yourself. The Bible always opens up to you a world that is bigger than your own imagination and reality. It welcomes you into a kingdom and a life that will so expand your conversation with God that you'll be talking to the God who is also talking to you through his word. The first temptation in the Garden of Eden in chapter 3, I'll get there, in chapter 3 was that the word of God, if you don't trust God, this is the serpent, that it will restrict you in such a way that you ought to leave. That's a temptation, that God's word will actually restrict you. Listen to me. It is not the word of God that restricts you. It is sin. 1 Timothy 4:4 tells us that bad theology restricts. That good theology receives with thanksgiving the whole of life with reverence and consecrates the whole of the created order back to God through his word and through prayer to be enjoyed by him. Even the constraints that God has given you in his law, those constraints, think about them like a good education. Those constraints actually open up a world of blessing and pleasure and goodness and power that enlarges your imagination for what is possible for you when you are no longer enslaved by sin. So that belonging to God, living in his covenant love, it opens up a kingdom to you and it makes your world much, much, much larger than the confines of Babylon. Do you see that? It's where you're living that restricts you. God is opening up a kingdom to you. In the life of obedience and in his word. He's done that for Daniel. You need vision, we need heart, we need to know life and its magnificent wonder with love at the center of it all. This is your prayer book to live in light of what Jesus has done for us and the wonder of his covenant love. Let's follow it together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word to us this morning. We pray that you would convince us once more, even in the life of your servant Daniel, who's literally writing your word as he's responding to it, that your word is life. The psalmist says in Psalm 119, it's sweeter than riches or treasure or anything else, and that to know you really does open up the possibility in a world of being made exactly who you meant us to be, fully in the image of your son. So we pray, Father, that you would grow us in that, you would teach us to pray. Father, we pray that you would actually, that you would help us to be repentant, to know what repentance is, to confess sin, and to live in the joy of that, as David talks about in Psalm 51, that joy is returned to us when we come to you with our sin, to stake our claim on the grace of God. Thank you for loving us in such a way. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together now and recite together the great thanksgiving at the top of page 16 in your bulletin as we prepare to take the Lord's Supper together. The Lord be with you. And with your spirit, lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right and good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks unto you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Thank you.
Please be seated. So we come to the table now to remember and to celebrate what God has done for us through Christ. And we do it over and over again to keep fresh in our minds that how he loved us and the fact that we are loved, that we belong in that suite. We belong because of what he's done. He's clothed us, as Chad just talked to us about. If this is your confession, if you can say, like the commentator Matthew Henry, that this table, in this table we declared Jesus' death to be our life, this table's for you. If you find your life, your hope, your only one true hope in Christ, then this table's open to you. But if you don't know the Lord, then I invite you to look at some of the prayers in the bulletin and come to Christ first, and then come to the table later. This is just to remind us and refresh our memory about who he is and what he's done for us. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that you love us. We thank you that you've given yourself for us. We thank you as we take this wine, this grape juice, this bread, and we're reminded of your great love for us, how it demonstrates what you've done for us. And you pursued us, and you have provided a way for us to be in your family, and that we belong because of you. Thank you, Lord. Sink that truth deep in our lives now, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Scripture tells us that on the night the Lord was betrayed, they took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of sins for many. Drink of it, all of you. For as often as you eat this bread or drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Christ our Passover Lamb has been sacrificed for us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take these in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, and drink remembering that Christ's blood has been shed for you. It is our practice here to come forward to communion. If you cannot come forward, just tell one of the ushers. We would be delighted to come to you and serve you communion. As a reminder, there's grape juice on the outer rim, and the rest of it inside the outer rim is wine. Let's now, as we come forward, just remember and celebrate our great Lord.
Oh,
brothers and sisters, friends, lift your eyes to heaven now and receive this, the Lord's blessing, his benediction, his word for you as you go. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Let us go out now and serve the world and our city as those who love our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said together, thanks be to God. Amen. Go in peace.